Welcome back to the Gridiron Expert. We have finished our game-by-game predictions for every single PAC-12 team, which means it's time to take a look at our projected PAC-12 standings for the 2021 college football season. Before we get started, guys, as always, make sure to continue to like, comment, subscribe, share our videos, and also make sure to check out everything down in the description below. And that includes, as always, those expert picks, some of the best college football and NFL spread picks in the country over on our website, thegridironexpert.com. Make sure to go sign up for those today before the season starts, guys. We are just about a month away from the start of the college football season. I can promise you do not want to miss out on these picks, so make sure to go sign up today before we get the ball rolling. Speaking of getting the ball rolling, let's just go ahead and do it right now. Let's go ahead and jump into our projected standings. Again, we're not going to tell you the game-by-game predictions for these teams. We've done individual videos for all of these teams. So if you want extra analysis on all 12 of these teams, just go find the individual video for them. We've got usually 16 to 20 minutes on each team on every single win and loss and why. So make sure you go give that a look. Today's just a brief overview and recap. We're going to go ahead and start in the North, where it should be no surprise we have Oregon winning the North Division yet again. We have the Ducks finishing 10-2, 8-1 in conference play. You know, we've said it over and over. We believe the Ducks are just in a bit of a league of their own. Joe Moorhead running that RPO-style offense up in Eugene with a dual-threat quarterback in Anthony Brown. You've got your top two rushers back in Travis Dye and C.J. Ferdell. You've got your top two wide receivers back in Johnny Johnson III and Jalen Redd. Everybody's back for Oregon, and the defense has one of the best defensive linemen in the country in Kayvon Thibodeau. Oregon is the team to beat in the PAC-12. They've won the last two PAC-12 championships. They are the team to beat until proven otherwise. The team that can give them a run for their money, though, is Washington. The Huskies are their biggest threat in the North. Jimmy Lake's squad should have won the North last year. They should have been playing for a PAC-12 title, but they had to sit out due to COVID. We have the Huskies going 9-3, 7-2 in conference play. That game against Oregon, Oregon and Washington in Seattle on November 6th, could very well determine who wins the division. Could very well determine who wins the division. The Huskies return just about everybody from last year's squad that went 3-1. They are out to prove something. They are a team on a mission. And I have complete and utter faith in Jimmy Lake and the Huskies. We have them falling just short of winning the division, but do not be surprised if they do. This team is extremely talented, and the schedule lines up very favorably for them as they get to host both Oregon and Arizona State in consecutive weeks. We have California coming in at third in the North, 7-5, 5-4 in conference play. Maybe the best team of the Justin Wilcox era, especially on the offensive side of the ball. Chase Garbers is back as the most experienced quarterback in the PAC-12, 23 starts to his name. If he can stay healthy, this offense can skyrocket, be the best that they have seen under Justin Wilcox. We know the defense is going to be strong, especially in the secondary. So California is a team that could be your dark horse North team if you wanted to go that far, but their schedule proves to be very difficult. They have to travel to Washington. They have to travel to Oregon. They have to travel to Stanford and UCLA. Of course, they draw USC out of the South, and then of course have a non-conference game at TCU. The schedule is very difficult for Justin Wilcox in California, but they should go bowling. We have them a little bit above that, 7-5. After that, the remaining teams in the North we have failing to make the postseason. Stanford coming in at 5-7. They were a team that was nearly a bowl team for us. Borderline bowl eligible for us, falling just short at 5-7. You know, we had a couple toss-up games that we mentioned in our Stanford prediction video. The major cause of concern for Stanford right now is their offense. We know their back seven and their defense is going to be so strong. We feel very confident in that from David Shaw. But can they get anything going offensively with a new quarterback in Jack West? That's the million-dollar question here. We have Stanford at 5-7, though, but four of those five wins are coming in conference play. Again, there are three toss-up games on Stanford's schedule where if they win just one of them, they go bowling. If you want to find out which three of those are, make sure to go tune into our Stanford video. Washington State, also at 5-7, but 3-6 in conference play. They're going to improve in year two under Nick Rolovich. That run-and-shoot offense. The Cougars are extremely young. Young quarterback in Jaden Delora. Certainly young on the defensive side of the ball, too, where they gave up 307 passing yards per game. That could be their downfall yet again in many of their conference games this season. They have to improve defensively. They will flirt with bowl eligibility, but we believe they're still one more year away from that. And finally, rounding out the North, we have Oregon State, who comes in at 3-9, 1-8 in Pac-12 conference play. And I know you Oregon State fans are going to hate me for that. You're going to say I'm wrong. You're going to say I'm an idiot. You're going to hate it. And look, understandably so. But as we've said over and over again, Oregon State, we believe, is a team that's going to be much better than their final record indicates. They have a brutal schedule, too. A road game at Purdue to kick things off, at USC, at California, at Colorado, at Oregon. They draw Arizona State out of the South, along with USC, as we just mentioned. It's a tough schedule. Utah out of the South as well. It's a tough schedule for Jonathan Smith and the Beavers, a program that hasn't gone bowling in 8 years. And we don't expect that to change now in 2021. They do have some talent. They are going to be competitive. But with a tough schedule like this, we just don't see them racking up the wins. Again, 3-9, but they're going to be much better than that final record. We switch gears and go over to the South. Oregon has won the North. Who will they play in the Pac-12 championship game? Well, you can already see it. It's going to be Utah. And as you can see, we have a three-way tie in conference play between Utah, Arizona State, and USC. Those are the three biggest contenders in the Pac-12 South. Any one of those three teams can win the division, no doubt in my mind. We believe it's going to be the Utes. 10-2, 7-2 in conference play. They return 18 starters, guys. 18 starters, 10 on offense. Kyle Whittingham did a phenomenal job of going out and utilizing the transfer portal. They bring in Charlie Brewer, the transfer quarterback from Baylor, who threw for 9,700 yards and 65 touchdowns during his time in Waco. He's got TJ Pledger at running back from Oklahoma, Chris Curry at running back from LSU. The talent is there for Utah. Let's not forget they were 11th in the nation last year in stopping the run. Utah is maybe my favorite, obviously the favorite to win the Pac-12 South in our eyes. We have them winning it. And again, a team that to me isn't getting enough attention. USC and Arizona State stealing it off from them. And no disrespect to either of those two programs. Obviously, we believe both of them to do very well. We have Herm Edwards in the Sun Devils going 10-2, 7-2 as well. So, you know, if you piece it together, we obviously see Utah defeating Arizona State on October 16th, owning that tiebreaker. Now, we know the Sun Devils are in the midst of a major recruiting scandal right now. As we mentioned, if more information on that unfolds before the season starts, we might come back and change our Arizona State prediction. But as of right now, we know nothing. As of right now, nothing has happened from the NCAA. Their investigation is ongoing. And until they drop the hammer on the Sun Devils, we're going to go as if nothing has happened. Arizona State has the talent to go 10-2 with Rashad White and Jaden Daniels and 8 starters on defense from what many believe, as we've said, could be one of the best defenses in Arizona State history. 10-2, 7-2. A double-digit win season for Herm Edwards is unbelievable, but Sun Devil fans are going to just be devastated that they fall just short of winning the division. USC comes in at 9-3. They're going to finish third in the South, but in a three-way tie for first. How crazy is that? And obviously, based on the tiebreaker scenarios, this is just how it all unfolds. 9-3, the million-dollar question is that going to be enough to save Clay Helton's job out in L.A.? Is that going to be enough? They went 5-0 last year in the regular season, but lost the Pac-12 championship game. They're not even going to make the Pac-12 championship game this year, at least in our eyes. The talent is there. Keaton Slovis, Drake London, Katie Nixon, Brew McCoy, Keontae Ingram transferring in from Texas at running back, and Todd Orlando in year two with 6 returning starters on defense. Will 9-3 be enough to save Clay Helton's job? Our gut says no. He's not producing championships. He's not winning championships. 9-3 with a shot at 10, but Clay Helton might not be around to help them get to that 10. The bottom three of the Pac-12 South is kind of explanatory, very similar to the North. You have 3 elite teams. Really, you could say 2 elite teams in the North, 3 elite teams in the South, but there's a fine line drawn at the midway point of each division. It happens right here with the bottom three here in the South. We got UCLA coming in at 5-7. UCLA, to me, is the equivalent. Obviously, have the same record as Stanford and Washington State. A team that we don't exactly know what to expect from, but a team we expect to flirt with bowl eligibility. A team that we believe can get there under Chip Kelly. There are just a few games that they need to go their way. And again, like Washington State, like Stanford, there are 3 games that we believe are almost toss-ups for UCLA. And if they just win one of them, They're going bowling in year four under Chip Kelly. He's keeping his job, and the future is looking very bright. So if you want to find out which games those are, make sure to go check out our analysis for the Bruins. But 19 returning starters are back for UCLA. 19 returning starters are back. The talent is there. The schedule is just going to make it very, very difficult. At USC, at Utah, drawing Oregon, at Washington, Arizona State, LSU in week one. Such a difficult schedule for Chip Kelly and the Bruins. It's going to be interesting to see how they handle that. Colorado in at 4-8. If you remember, Colorado nearly won the Pac-12 South last year. Many will say, how can they almost win the division last year, now come back, not even make a bowl game? Obviously, they're playing a full schedule. They play Texas A&M. They play Minnesota in the non-conference. They have to go to Oregon. They host Washington. They have to go to Utah, California, Arizona State. It's a brutal schedule. But the Buffaloes are going to have a very potent rushing attack. While we have them at 4-8, we're not saying they're not going to be competitive. And that's something that Colorado fans have been wanting for a long, long time. They want bowl games. They want championships. But they want to be able to watch their team the whole way through and not turn it off after the first quarter. And Carl Durrell is going to prevent that. With Brendan Lewis, Jerick Broussard, and Alex Fontenot, the Buffaloes, I believe, will be competitive in almost every single game they play. But they're going to fall short in just a few of them. That's going to keep them out of the postseason. Now, rounding out the Pac-12 guys in the South, Arizona. 2-10, winless in conference play. And this shouldn't come as a surprise to too many people. Arizona was the worst team in the Pac-12 last year. They went winless, going 0-5. Now they're dealing with a brand new head coach in Jed Fish. Quarterback questions across the board. Probably going to be Gunnar Cruz, the freshman transfer from Washington State. But quarterback questions across the board. A defense that, yes, is now led by Don Brown, the former Michigan defensive coordinator. But a defense that still gave up over 270 rushing yards per game. You know, you can't just, you know, wave your magic wand and make an elite defense in 1 year. It's going to take a lot of time for things to get better down in Tucson. Arizona, like many teams, has a very difficult schedule. The talent simply is not there. A lot of growing pains for Jed Fish down in Tucson. He'll get there, but Wildcat fans, be patient. 2021 is not going to be the year you see anything come out of Tucson. So having said all of that, with these 12 teams, we have Oregon and Utah in the Pac-12 championship game out in Las Vegas. This was the Pac-12 championship game 2 years ago. Utah, had they won that game, would have gone to the college football playoff. These two teams meet each other on November 20th. So they play on November 20th and very well could play again about 2 weeks later. Unfortunately, there will not be a playoff berth on the line for either team, at least in our eyes. Each has two losses. Regardless of who wins this game, neither will make the college football playoff. But a conference title and a Rose Bowl berth is on the line. It is on the line. 2 years ago, Oregon ruined Utah's playoff hopes. Oregon ruined Utah's playoff hopes. This year, we think Utah ruins Oregon's playoff hopes as we have the Utes winning against Oregon in the regular season on November 20th. So in this rematch, just a few weeks later, who do we have capturing the 2021 Pac-12 champion or championship? We believe it's going to be the Oregon Ducks. Again, call it a three-peat, baby. Trademark it. The Ducks are going to win their third straight Pac-12 championship. Mario Cristobal continuing to do amazing things in Eugene. Yes, the Ducks are going to fall short of the college football playoff. That is the ultimate goal. But they're going to win a third straight conference title. They're going to go back to the Rose Bowl. And don't be surprised if they win that Rose Bowl to capture a 12-win season. They're doing everything they can. They're doing everything right in Eugene. The only thing that's missing is a playoff berth, and I have a feeling they're closing in on that very, very soon. Not going to be 2021, but very, very soon. But for the third straight year, Oregon wins the Pac-12, and again, will be kings of the conference until proven otherwise. So guys, as always, thank you so much for watching us here at the Gridiron Expert on YouTube. Our Pac-12 projected standings for 2021. Let's hear your thoughts down in the comments below. We're getting ready to move on to our next conference. Only two left for game-by-game predictions, which means the season's getting close. Make sure to check out everything down in the description, guys. Again, make sure to sign up for those expert picks. Sign up today before the season starts. I promise you're not going to regret it. You're not going to want to miss out. And once again, guys, as always, thank you so much for watching. And we'll see you next time right here on the Gridiron Expert.